Good afternoon. I'd like to welcome you all to this third event in our spring series of the project on Russian and Eurasian Jewry here at the Davis Center. I'm Maxim Schreier, and I want to welcome Ellendea Proffer Teasley, who is a distinguished guest, and I'm very, very happy she is here with us. I want to tell you that we have one more event in our project, and there are flyers here, so please help yourselves to them. On May 2nd, Patricia Herlihy will be speaking about her new book and on the Jewish community of Odessa, so please join us for that event. And the subject of this afternoon's presentation, Joseph Brodsky used to say, and I heard him say this several times, that time stolen from, that time taken for the introduction is time stolen for, stolen from the presentation. It sounds better in Russian because he said, время украденное, время потраченное на вступление есть время украденное у выступления. So the pun is a little better in English, but the idea is the same. So this will be a very short introduction. I just want to say that Ellendea Proffer Teasley is a legendary name in Russian studies in America, in American letters, and in the history of Russian literature. She co-founded with the late Carl Proffer both Ardis Publishers and the journal Russian Literature, Triquarterly. And for those of you who may not be in Russian studies or may not be readers of Russian literature, this is a publisher that was absolutely instrumental in bringing Russian literature in translation to the Anglo-American audience, in publishing Russian emigre literature in Russian, but also in publishing works that could not be published in the Soviet Union. And those of us who grew up in the Soviet Union in the 1970s and 80s remember well these books that were smuggled or brought to the Soviet Union, and they were widely circulated, they were copied, and that's how many of us read our first Nabokovs or our first Brodskys, precisely in those circumstances. Ellendea Proffer Teasley is the author of a number of books, including Vladimir Nabokov, A Pictorial Biography, Mikhail Bulgakov, Life and Work, and most recently, the book that she will be speaking about this afternoon, this book, Brodsky Among Us, and its Russian twin, Brodsky Sredi Nas. And I should conclude this introduction by telling you that it's a remarkable story of a book that traveled from California to Boston by way of Moscow. And with that in mind, I give you Ellendea Proffer Teasley. Please help me welcome her.
I should say thank you to two people who are here today. First of all, Marianne Sporlock, who kept running into Maxim Schreier at cocktail parties and discussing that I did not have an American publisher for my book yet. And Maxim, thank you for inviting me to this series. Now, the series is about Russian Jewish writers. As I understand it, it's to support an interest in Jewish culture. I'm afraid I can't help you there, because Brodsky, although persecuted for being a Jew, not least of all by his father and mother-in-law, who would not let him in the house in Russia, was in no way a Jew any more than, say, I am. I probably knew more about the Talmud and Torah than he did, which was typical of the Soviet intelligentsia at that time. But in the stories that I'm going to tell you, you must imagine that 90% of the people I'm talking about are what we would call genetically Jewish or Jewish by Israeli standards. But they were kind of Jewish the way Golda Meir was Jewish or the way Herzl was Jewish, which is to say not religious, but proud and never going to deny that they were Jewish. So this is the Jewish part of the program I have taken care of here. I'm going to talk about the book, but I'm going to approach it a little bit from the side, because I've been thinking about my life, which was dedicated to Russian literature since I was 25, in a different way lately. As I lived it, as Carl lived it, as all the people at Ardis lived it, many editors are here today, it was one thing happening after another. It was just the next logical step. There was no plan. There was no grand scheme. But when I look at it now, I look at it in a systems way. And it seems to me, these are purely opinions. There's no deep research backing it up, but there's a lifetime backing it up. Just like my book is, Russians complained that my book was so short, and I said, yet I had to live an entire life to write that book. High censorship societies are societies with bad statistics. This is not sufficiently remarked upon. Today's China, for example, doesn't even know how many people it has, because it's centralized and there's fear in that system, and it comes down to a man in an office in a remote province who fills out a form and lies on the form because half the people he knows had more than one child during the one-child policy. This is a typical problem of control. Russia tries to control the internet, lots of luck with that. But if you really control the internet, if you really control everything, and if you do as China does now, and you're planning to have facial recognition for every citizen, you pay an enormous price. And those of us that dealt with the Soviet Union saw that price, which is you become cut off from your own people and their own deepest thoughts, because they are not going to tell the Levada Center whether they like Putin or not, because you've got their phone number and their name. So if you think that you know what the Russian mass thinks, maybe yes, maybe no. So these issues of censorship are primary, because control is exerted not just through jails, it's mental. And I can tell you, as I was writing this book about Brodsky, I myself experienced internal censorship, as my husband Ross could tell you, which is, as I began to talk about his real character, which was in no way unusual for a great poet, by the way, let's think of Robert Lowell, or let's think of Pushkin. These are not exactly people you want your daughter to marry, let us face it. I understood that in Russian culture, this information was not going to be welcome, especially by his friends, and part of me wanted to gloss over it. This has a name. This is self-imposed internal censorship. If I, sitting in California in a free country, no matter what you think of it right now, it's still a free country, could have internal censorship, I want you to imagine what somebody in Russia had during the Soviet period. And even now, during my book tours with this book, the Russian version, which was a bestseller in Russia, much to my amazement, and I'm still thinking about why that should be, people were very afraid. They were afraid for me. They were afraid for their future. And I began to see that Brodsky wasn't just a superstar. He's like a rock star, say Bob Dylan at 20. He's also a symbol, and the symbol is a defiant man who, under the worst situation, said fuck you to the Soviet government. Now, there was a small group of people who did that, but he was not particularly political. This is the interesting part. He was simply somebody who said, I don't believe in what you believe. I'm going to find my own way through life. It's as if he were born into a cult, and he said, I don't believe in your God. And that, of course, was very unacceptable. So Brodsky appears to me to have become the face of the resistance, the face of a future that could be better, because the audiences that came, I went in 2015 with my book, and then 2017, this last April, with Carl Proffer's book, The Widows of Russia, and I included his unedited memoirs of Brodsky. It's available now on Amazon in an ebook in English. Anyway, but the Russians grabbed that and published it because they felt like this was a hot topic. Now, why should it be a hot topic? There are hundreds of books on Brodsky. That is still a mystery to me. And they're not all bad. There was one class where they simply attack him and said, you know, he never should have gotten the Nobel Prize. This was all a hustle. And they would bring up all his worst moments. And then all the other books, which was the preponderance, were hagiographic. Our great philosopher, king, poet, who was tortured by his government, and so on and so on and so on. So there wasn't a whole lot of middle ground, but there were important books. Palukhina did major work in the volumes she called Brodsky Through the Eyes of His Contemporaries, a very valuable source for anybody who wants to know what he was sort of like. And Lyudmila Stern, when she writes about the young Brodsky, I believe absolutely every word. So it's not like nobody had written about him. But I knew him in all weathers, and I knew him in both countries, and I had consistent knowledge of him in America, which a lot of the emigres did not, because Joseph in America could be the Russian Joseph with his emigre friends, and then somebody entirely different with the New York literati. And I was a witness to all of these versions. And because Carl and I helped him get out, we got to see him under duress in a very intimate situation. And he was like a brother to us, a brother we were deeply concerned about. But back to the idea of control and what Joseph means. Monoliths aren't really monoliths, even in Northern Korea. And of course, China, for anybody who went through the Soviet period, it's repeating a lot of the same behaviors. It's, let me give you a little bit of freedom, but then let me put some controls on. Well, that didn't work for Gorbachev, and I don't think it's going to work for them. But this need to control breeds in certain people supersonic defiance, and that was Brodsky. It wasn't even political. It was that he wanted to see the world. He wanted to have the life that he could imagine, and he had a sense of his own destiny. So when the young would come to my talks, they asked very odd questions. Like as time went on and it became clear to them, well, first of all, they were surprised I knew Russian, which was pretty funny to me. Like how they thought I was going to run a Russian publishing house and not know Russian. Dovlatov's daughter said, I didn't know you knew Russian. And I said, how would I socialize with your mother if I didn't know Russian? I've known her, you know, most of my life. I was coming to them, I was speaking in Russian, at a time when they feel cut off, at a time when they feel that the door is closing, the curtain is rising in the wrong way. And they said, don't you think that we're going back? Don't you think this is like Brezhnev? And I said, no, not at all. You can leave. And what became clear, my husband would talk to people while I was speaking, what became clear is these 20, 25-year-olds, their parents aren't telling them anything. That was astounding to me. I'm telling them, well, you know, a lot of your history was cut out in the Soviet period, and not all of it's come back. I was in a packed bookstore in Petersburg, and I said, how many people here know who Maria Spiridonova was? Three people put up their hands, two of them my age, one younger. The only woman to ever head a major political party in Russia. Because the Soviets were so good at wiping out their own history that you had to work very hard to find it. And they said, we thought we found out everything in the 90s. I said, you can't. There's not enough time. So much was cut out. So what they were asking me was, you knew Joseph. You're from a free culture. Are we about to lose the freedoms we have now? Because this is the generation that came of age when, well, before things were really bad. And of course, the people like Anton Dolin and that whole group that came of age in the 90s, no matter how hard the 90s were, for them it was freedom. It was real freedom. You could say, you could write, you could read what you wanted. It's already changing. But of course, it's not the Soviet Union. There isn't a governing theology. So back to the monolith and why why Ardis did what it did and why these children were coming to see me, because they felt something about me. Their parents had, they couldn't know me themselves. I'm not that famous. But their parents knew me, or their grandparents knew me. These monoliths always have cracks. Monoliths always have underground channels. And when I look at my life now and what we all did at Ardis, what I see is people in the Soviet Union needed information. And sometimes it's amazing where they got it, because the statistics were falsified. It came down to a man in a field who said, yes, we've grown enough wheat for the quota. Yes, we have enough of this, enough of that. And these were lies. The statistics have been unreliable. Like, think demographically since the middle of the 30s. I mean, the great defector came out and said, you know, in 1936, we saw 30 people had disappeared from the census. So this had to be covered up. So what did they do when they finally needed their statistics? They came to the work of a bureaucrat in Washington, D.C., Mary Feshbach. So I will call Mary Feshbach the necessary outsider. I don't think you knew Russian very well, which is a big minus, but he knew all kinds of other ways to induce birth rates, death rates, army age rates. And after the wall fell, the Russians admitted that when they wanted statistics, they came to Murray Feshbach. Another great necessary outsider was Robert Conquest. No Russian could write about the terror until the wall fell. And yet, the terror had to be written about. It was a remarkable event, a remarkable time. Some of the 30 million that were missing in the census were in the terror. Robert Conquest, without setting foot in the Soviet Union, wrote A History of the Terror, which stands up pretty well till this day. All right, so those things don't happen by accident. There has to be a signal from the target culture. Like when China began to rise, there was a thing called the Beige Book. I don't know if you know what the Beige Book was. All the investors who were not Chinese understood that there were no decent statistics about Chinese industries, and there still aren't, by the way. They made up their own book, the Beige Book, to make the best guess possible on where things were growing and where things were failing and what factories were working. Yeah. So you see this signal go out. Somebody inside the system needs information. So Ardis was Russian literature. Why would you need Russian literature? Well, because a lot of your literature had dropped out. A lot of your major names, say Mandelstam, were forgotten by the new generation unless they knew somebody from the old generation who would tell them. And what I saw in Russia now, for whatever reason, the older generation is not particularly educating the younger ones on what the Soviet period was really like, because it wasn't just control. It was theological and it was totalitarian. Whatever you want to say about what's going on now, that is not the same thing. It is simply not the same thing. So I see my life like this. Russian literature needed an outlet. It needed its lost books restored to it. And we did that. We did that kind of instinctively, but then the Russian writers came to us and said, we can't publish the books in Russia. Let's publish it with you. You're not that political a publishing house. They won't even know about it. Let's do that, and it'll be smuggled back. So this is the background that I have when I write this book about Brodsky. I did not want to write this book. I'm not interested in memoirs. I have other projects. I was in the middle of a big project. And it was like one day I understood I was getting old. And one day I understood I might forget certain aspects of this really remarkable man who was a spectacular personality. I spent my life with writers. I knew Nabokov. And as I began, I went to dinner with Borges, although it didn't do me much good. I've known a lot of famous writers. But nobody else needed to be written about. They had been written about and well, and a coherent personality had emerged. For some reason with Joseph, partly because his fame now, I mean, he's on coffee mugs. So the young audience has said, what do you feel about Brodsky being on a coffee mug? And I said, I don't mind it. A Vermeer on a coffee mug is still a reminder that Vermeer existed. I don't mind it. People would do things like write on the internet, I won't date a man who hasn't read Brodsky. That's my ultimate test. And these were not literary people. It was Joseph as a symbol of all that was independent, and of course, great love poetry. But he also wrote very difficult poetry. Joseph himself would be stunned at what's gone on with his reputation and how much they've made a martyr of him, including people who knew him very well and know it wasn't like that. So in my book, I made sure to use our notes on how Joseph got out and how much he wanted to get out. And some of Joseph's friends, especially in Petersburg, are very unhappy about this book because I'm telling not everything I know. One audience said, you're not telling everything you know. I said, that's right. Why would I tell you everything I know? I'm telling you 25%, but it's a reliable 25%, which is more than they're getting from the people who knew even more than I did. But they didn't know about him in America. And the Russian tendency is to minimize the American contribution to any field, to any endeavor, because it must be only Russians. Russians would say of my book, you know, what can an American woman know about Brodsky? I understand that. I do understand that. But we don't say that about de Tocqueville when he writes about America. We don't say, what can a Frenchman with not that good a brand of English know about America? He knew a lot. And like now, Thomas Piketty, another Frenchman, has changed our discussion of equality in America. So we have our significant outsiders too, especially on the question of race. But this is an open society. These discussions are available to everyone. You can't get imprisoned for discussing these things that are wrong with our society. Whereas in Russia, it's getting colder, but it's still not the Soviets. So I didn't want to write the book. And one day I understood I was old and that I was going to forget. And that my particular Joseph, because of course everybody has their own Joseph, my particular Joseph had not shown up anywhere. And I knew things nobody else knew. And I was compelled to write it. But halfway through, I could feel him saying to me, don't do this. In Russian, it would be не надо, не надо, не надо. But I did it. And I sent the manuscript to the old Russia hands in America. So that includes David Remnick at the New Yorker, who was a correspondent when I was there, Robert Kaiser, who ran the Washington Post, a correspondent when I was there, Ron Meyer, a translator and editor of Ardis, Marianne Schmorlich, the same at Ardis, a whole group of people. But they were all people with connections to Russia. So when they were reading my book, and they had all known Joseph to one degree or another, they were reliving their youth. That was our youth. But then I gave it to somebody who knew nothing about Russia and wasn't her youth, and she was much younger. And she stayed up reading it, and she just said, what an interesting person, and what interesting life conditions. Because to convey how hard it was in the Soviet period, just the tax on Joseph as he leaves and loses his citizenship, that he had to pay for that. You know, it was just, it's the little details. So I expected nothing. My American friends liked it, but they said, it's a long essay. Where in the hell can you publish it? Nobody's interested in Brodsky. And the reason nobody's interested in Brodsky is because of the quality of the translations. He's due to be retranslated almost everything, and a lot of the major things have not been translated at all. The estate has controlled everything, but now there are rumors that there are going to be new translations. I hope so, because he is a really great poet, but poetry doesn't always translate. So they didn't see where it was going to be published. A couple people tried. They really, really liked it. A couple publishing houses. Didn't work out. Around this same time that I'm writing, a Russian magazine came to interview me and photograph me. And they asked the musical question, what are you working on right now? And I said, I'm working on a memoir of Brodsky. And that's all it said in the interview. After that interview was published, three publishers got a hold of me and said, we're interested in that memoir. Now, at this time, I did not know Brodsky was a rock star in Russia. I had no idea of the gigantic fame he now had. I was surprised. And then a journalist named Alexander Guinness, who had met me and found out I was working on this, got a hold of a wonderful publisher who I did not know, named Varya Gunastayeva of a publishing house called Corpus. And he said, Varya, Ellendea is working on that book. I'm the only Ellendea in Russian literature, by the way. And he said, grab it. He said, squatty. Anyway, so I ended up publishing it, but I warned her. I said, you know, there's a million books on Brodsky. You may lose your shirt on this. Publishing is not very remunerative in Russia any more than it is here. I think only Akunin and a couple other people, Sorokin, sell a lot of copies. So a normal print run is 3,000. You're doing fine if you sell 3,000. People spending money on books, not so much. So she took it, and I went for the book tour and was absolutely astounded by the reception, especially the young ones, because I did not imagine that they could know who I was. But it was like maybe they didn't know who I was, but they sensed something, and they wanted to be near somebody who had known Joseph. And they would come up to me, and they would say things in Russian like, thank you for existing. Спасибо, что вы есть. I mean, just these amazing things. And then I was interviewed on radio, TV, everything. And then met the creme de la creme and a lot of billionaires, none of whom I recognized, none of whom I knew. And it was an amazing trip because they have PR now and they have the internet now. And the second trip, already things were getting tighter. My book was not sent to be reviewed by the major dailies because my publishing house is in opposition. They do not want to send the book to anybody pro-Putin. So all of these underground wars are being fought on a daily level. And all I can say to you is that I'm still kind of mystified at why they liked it. People said he's very alive there. And that's good. I wanted him to be alive in my book. I wanted you to feel the magic and the irritation of this remarkable person. All right, I think we could take some questions now. Okay.
Wonderful. Thank you, Ellendea. I just want to say because I think I failed to say that. Is this working? Yeah. That Ellendea's book is available for sale, and she'll sign copies after we take questions.
The English book.
Okay. Yes. Yeah, so the Russian you're going to have to procure on your own, and it's hard to procure, I'm told. Correct? And also to say that this whole series and this event is sponsored by Genesis Philanthropy Group, and it's sponsoring wonderful events in the field of Jewish-Russian culture, and also by the Center for Jewish Studies here at Harvard. And so, Ellendea, thank you. I'm just going to help moderate this, and the mic will travel around.
First of all, I just don't know what to say to bow you. You are really my icon, because I came to America and 73 and 75, I knew about your publishing house. And with my students from Boston University, Columbia University, probably around 100 copies of Ardis I sent to Moscow and to St. Petersburg. And you are not only my icon, you are definitely still their icon. And I don't agree with all the generation didn't tell younger generation about this publishing house. As far as I know, they do know. And this is, I think, one of the reasons why your books were so successful, because when you somewhere, it was this kind of couple which helped us to read real literature, and we didn't forget this. And thank you very, very much for this.
It's thank you.
And probably a short question. What has happened? I know that you sold your Ardis publishing house. What is going on with this? No more Russian literature, or what?
I did not sell Overlook, which is now bought by Penguin or something. I did not sell any of the Russian language titles. I sold some of the English, and they reprinted some of the English. So Catherine O'Connor and Diana Bergen, they're here tonight. Their excellent translation of Master Margarita is controlled by them through, what is it, Penguin, Catherine? Who? Yeah. Yeah. So they go on, but none of us get any money from it. We just sold the titles. So it's not really Ardis. They're using the Ardis name, but you can tell when it's not really Ardis because they say Ardis Publishing when it was really Ardis Publishers.
Wonderful. More questions, please.
Hello. Thank you very much for being here. I have a question. One of my friends of a younger generation, she's a poet in today's Russia. She wrote when the things started getting really bad lately. She said that this time gonna bring great movies and a wonderful literature. Грядет большое кино и великая литература. Do you agree with that? Do you think that's something specific for Russia? Can you elaborate on that a little? Thank you.
She thinks that now there will be great movies. There are great movies. We actually met Zhaginsev when we were there. I think Lviv Fun is a great movie. I don't have these rules, but I will tell you that literary agents told me that when the generals in Argentina, after they left power, it took 10 years before there was any decent literature out of Argentina. And that's a literary culture. One of their major writers, Sorokin, is living in Germany. Ulitskaya is back and forth all the time. I'm not sure. I think there will always be writers in Russia because it's a very, very literary culture. It's a powerful literary culture. And there are movies, but the problem with movies is they're easy to censor and they're easy not to give the money for. I think the good Russian movies are being produced outside of Russia, so I don't know what you call them. I'm not sure that's true. I'm not sure.
I'm American, was married to a Soviet Georgian Jew, and just fascinated by Russian Jewish culture. And I'm just fascinated to hear that you went to the Soviet Union. I remember in San Francisco I was just in high school, going to the consulate in San Francisco, and we heard poetry read, and I'm just fascinated to think what brought you, what took you over, and when you actually went to the Soviet Union, and your story, and I can understand somebody Jewish and not Jewish just seems.
Yeah, no, I'm not Jewish, and my husband wasn't Jewish either. It's a great literature. We were literature scholars, and Russian literature was our chosen field. And in 1969, we went on a scholars exchange and lived there for 6 months, which wouldn't have really given us much because Russia was very hard to break into at that point because everybody was so afraid of foreigners. But we had a letter from a great woman, Nadezhda Mandelstam, the author of remarkable memoirs and the widow of, I would say, Russia's greatest poet of the 20th century, for me anyway. We had a letter of recommendation to her. and she liked us, and then she introduced us into the entire literary world. We would have had nothing without her. This was all. And the reason we got that letter is because Carl was a Nabokov scholar and was in correspondence with Nabokov. And another Nabokov scholar was a friend of Nadezhda's, and so it all came together. He said, you're going. I want you to see Nadezhda Mandelstam. So that is how everything. And then we went every year until they banned us. They banned us when we did a thing called Metropole, which was not really a political thing. It was an almanac, but it was done by the star writers of Russia, plus some very young ones. They had decided they didn't want censorship, so they put together this thing, and they said, we want you to publish it as it is, and the Russian censors said no. So they sent it to us, and we published it. Well, the minute we published that, I mean, Vosnesensky was in it, Aksyonov was in it. Everybody got punished. Everybody got punished. And we were denied visas then until 87. Carl had died in 84. 87, I got to the book fair. And the book fairs were remarkable events in general for us. But and then I went back, you know, a fair amount after that.
Ellendea, if I might jump in for just one second. I know the short opening was mandatory and you dealt with that really deftly. I just want to mention something because you spoke about how particularly some of Brodsky's older friends were unhappy with the chapters, with the pages that dealt with Brodsky's emigration and with your absolutely lucid understanding of the fact that he sought it and he was interested in it. From my personal experience, having been teaching Brodsky and writing about it, one of the puzzling things, I just want to see if I have this image because I was just teaching it. One of the most puzzling things that I've encountered is whenever people see this image, this is the exit visa, and find out that Brodsky left the Soviet Union on an Israeli visa, people are shocked. And, you know, I tire of making this point time and again.
Well, he didn't want... He never went to Israel. Let us make that perfectly clear. He never went to Israel. He did not want to go to Israel. And we were in his room when the KGB called, which was OVIR, the Office of Visa and Passports. And Carl just said, you know, you'll get to Vienna, I'll meet you, and we'll get you into America somehow. And Joseph didn't understand that it was really hard to get into America when your visa was for Israel, not for America. Vienna was a stop. It's hard to explain to people who are too young, but Vienna was a stop place on the way to, you know, Rome, Israel, and so on. He didn't want to be like other emigres in any way, and he wasn't.
Yeah. And, you know, Isaiah Berlin said he didn't want to be a Jewish Jew. You know, in one of the last conversations about Joseph Brodsky, that's specifically how he phrased it.
Except that Joseph, when we met him and when he met people, almost the second thing he would say to you was, I'm Jewish. And as I say in the book, he, in our first meeting, because he had a strong Jewish accent, he said, you know, I have this Jew side, and he grabbed his throat. He said, I was sent when I was a little boy to get rid of this Jewish accent, and I refused to do it, which is so like him, just so like him. But it's also so like him to be, as it were, so Jewish and yet say, don't care about it at all.
Yeah, thank you. Please, more questions, comments?
This is the only time you will see me. I'm not writing any more books I'm doing this kind of stuff for, so you should ask.
Well, we're going to invite you back, regardless.
Be brave.
So you spoke tantalizingly about the various Brodskys and suggested that you had been in a position to know more than a few of them. I just wondered if you might elaborate that a little bit, how he was, let's say, in a specifically Russian emigre milieu versus a New York literary, all that.
Well,
Ellendea, this is Sven Birkertz, who has not introduced himself, but I think
he
knows a thing or two about Brodsky.
You actually wrote something on Brodsky, I
not
think.
Not just once.
Didn't you? Yeah. Yeah, yeah. I thought it was great what you wrote on him, and I advise you all to find it on the internet. This is Sven Birkertz, a very famous person. You know, it's in my book. I'm not going to go in too much detail because don't I have to lure you into buying my little book? This is all going to sound terrible. It's just going to sound terrible. See, this is the problem I had writing it. It's just all. He was a colossal snob. He would actually say to me and Carl, we're working in Ann Arbor, we're working, and Carl's teaching, I'm teaching, we have children, we have dogs, we have visiting Russians who would eat garlic in the morning and then start raving to me about how the Jews deserve the Holocaust because didn't they kill Christ? That was one breakfast. And this was from a Jewish writer, of course, who had been in Israel. So we had kind of a busy life. He would actually say things to us like, your friends are too ordinary. And I thought, my friends, Nadezhda Mandelstam, my friends, Nabokov, my friends, Marianne and Ron, okay. All right, so this because they weren't worldwide famous. His idea of a friend was, let's say, Abraham, Steven Spender, people like that. When he was with his old, I mean, these are generalizations, because believe me, no one could be more charming and wonderful than he could be. But sometimes when he was with his old emigre friends, he was extraordinarily condescending in tone and in vocabulary. Would be kind of like, well, old boy, you just don't understand America. And this old boy was making a living in America the hard way. He didn't have Carl helping him. He had a family and children to send to college, none of which Joseph had to deal with at that time. When he was with, well, one time I went to the pen club with him. And as I say, the walls were coated with testosterone. Very few women were in there in those years. It was the 80s. And E.L. Doctorow was there. And Joseph and he proceeded to have a verbal duel, which was so competitive, you just got tired watching. So that was one kind of thing. But when he was impressed by somebody, his voice would change, his body would change, and he would be working very hard to be impressive back. So that was very different. In Russia, he was a man of intimacy. And as he said, in Russia, he could tell who you were from 500 feet away by the way you walked, by the way you dressed, and he would treat you accordingly. You were somebody that mattered or somebody that didn't. Of course, if you were a beautiful woman, that was a whole different story. But when he got to America, you know, America's hard that way because we can dress very badly and be someone of significance. So he had to learn that. And then he would boast about the famous people he knew. And when he brought Susan Sontag to visit, he really brought Susan Sontag to visit. He got impressed, and they weren't more than he was. That was the sad part. They weren't more than he was. But it was like they were in a club he wanted to be part of. And I understand that. But he was a little too old for that. But, you know, it's been so long in Russia wanting to get out and, in essence, wanting to be an English language poet. That is my deepest belief. He denied that, but everything I saw made me think that. Does that answer it?
Yeah.
Yes.
Russia, Rubinstein.
Yes.
Now I'm going to identify the speakers.
That's all right.
I know, yeah.
Can you tell us anything about the circumstances surrounding his receipt of the Nobel Prize for Literature?
Not the hardcore ones, but I got this question. I got this question on a radio station in Petersburg where a very nasty man called up and said, I hear Brodsky got that award just because he had his crowd fight for him. He had his connections. And I said, everybody has connections, but not everybody gets the Nobel. But the connection he had was Czesław Miłosz, the great Polish poet. And Miłosz was in no way, in my experience of him, now I didn't know him so well, so maybe I'm wrong, he was in no way a political player. The Nobel, there's a lot of political maneuvering that goes on. But Milos and Joseph were both part of the Academy, and each year, Joseph told me, he and Milos would nominate each other. And I have no question that he also nominated Derek Walcott after knowing him. So I think if you get nominated a lot, your chances are higher. I don't know if it was political, but he's a great poet, so you know I was fine with it. Were there other people that deserved it? Probably, but you know, Nabokov never got it. Proust never got it. Yeah, lots of people never got it. But Joseph was really, really happy to get it. Yes, Baryshnikov is not happy. I wrote about that, by the way, apparently. Not happy with the book, period, which makes me sad because I liked him a lot. Well, you know, Joseph had dated a ballerina in Petersburg, and she had had his child, Anastasia. And she's actually the child, as far as I can tell, most like him. She is not recognized by the estate as a Brodsky, but all of us know that she is a Brodsky. So he was in the ballet world, and of course, Misha Baryshnikov was absolute star. And when he came out, Baryshnikov was extremely charming, and they were in different fields, but they were both very prominent, although Baryshnikov was famous beyond famous at that point, and still. I think they relaxed together. I think they had a good time together. They respected each other, and I think for Joseph, when you get really famous, a lot of your old friends want things from you. Misha didn't want anything from him, and he didn't want anything from Misha, although Misha later helped him in a significant way, which I hint at, but I'm not going to describe. I'm sorry. That's part of the 75% you don't get. Anyway, it was a real friendship, and of course, Baryshnikov's gone around with this production called Brodsky Baryshnikov. But I don't think he wanted anybody writing about that relationship. So.
Thank you.
And by the way, Valentina Paluchina recently published a long piece about that relationship.
Oh, really?
Yeah,
I haven't read it.
Yeah, which is quite extensive. Valentina Paluchina is one of the principal Western scholars of Brodsky that Ellendea mentioned before. She's British-based, yeah.
Brodsky through the eyes of his contemporaries, which your press published in both Russian and English, Brodsky через глаза современников. And it's got interviews with everybody in the world, and it's really big. It's not so well edited, but it's very valuable research source. I didn't know she'd done that. I'm not keeping up anymore.
No, I only mentioned it because you mentioned it, and I think it's the first extensive treatment.
Oh, he's going to hate that. He's going to hate that. Yes.
How do you explain such a popularity of Brodsky for last, I don't know, 10 years?
Because, it's unbelievable.
Right, and he's not a popular culture guy. It's very difficult to read his poetry.
Well, but the love poetry, you know, I Embrace Those Shoulders, or the very lovely poem called Love, which you can find on the internet, and it's a great poem. The love poetry, the young can understand. The other poetry, no. It's very difficult. It's metaphysical. It's hard. And he was proud of how hard it was. He was an elitist. But now he's beloved of the masses. And this is the central irony. I think it's what I said, that he's a defiant figure. He was persecuted in a remarkable way to send the poet to the Arctic Circle, to send the poet. Well, I mean, he went to the psychiatric unit as a way to get out of the entire thing. But he said the psychiatric unit was worse than the Arctic Circle. You know, this is a legendary story, to persecute a poet like this.
Right, but do you know, of course, about Bykov? His explanation that he was of a poet who write a lot about imperia. He wanted Russia to be imperia, and this is the reason. What do you
No,
feel?
This is not the reason for the young. They don't care. Bulgakov is also the one who said Nabokov was a pedophile, because how else could you write Lolita? Excuse me, I knew Nabokov, and I know Bulgakov a little. I don't think we need to take these things seriously. He was an imperial poet, but he meant the great empire, like the Roman Empire or the Chinese Empire, the empire that could have been, not the one that was. But he did write this unfortunate poem about Ukraine, and he really did, as I say, have a fight with Lev Kopolev about how Ukrainian was just a dialect of Russia. He really believed that. You know, if you're raised Soviet, it's hard not to believe in the Soviet Empire's myth, no matter who you are. No, I can't explain it. I can just say that it's who he was in life, plus the love poetry. But, you know, why it's not somebody else, I don't know. But they also lost him. You know, the power of the dead star, is very great. They lost him. They lost him early, and he was abroad. So, I don't know. Okay, anything?
Wonderful. Perhaps we'll take one more question, and then Ellendea will sign her books. Please. Let's just wait for the mic. Is that okay? One more
question. What's your party, dude?
Hello. So I grew up in the Soviet Union and left when I was still in high school. Now I'm a scholar or researcher in Russian literature. So my father told me that in the 70s, during the Brezhnev regime, some people were severely persecuted when the authorities found that they were reading Brodsky, and they were interrogated and beaten, which is kind of hard to imagine, because I thought that the Brezhnev regime was sort of more vegetarian. And yet it was like that. And then he told me about one specific case. It was called Дело 15. And I started looking everywhere, Дело 15. I started looking it up on the internet. I couldn't find anything. And then I found that he worked at some ремонтное отделение 15. But I'm still curious to find out more about that.
That one's not familiar, but you didn't get arrested just for reading Brodsky. You got arrested, like Maram Zin did, and we were involved in this whole case, for having produced a Samizdat 5-volume version. And when they found that, they also found our books. They found Russian Literature Triquarterly, which had a Russian language section. And they found, I think, Nabokov. And these were all entered into evidence, the trial for anti-Soviet propaganda. But that wasn't even the worst case. The worst case I knew was a guy who's now a famous scholar, Garek. Wow, I can't believe I've forgotten your last name, Garek. But anyway, he was an archive rat. He was like 30.
Oh, Gabriel Superfin. Yeah.
That's it. And he was an archive rat, and we were doing the journal, and we were on the street in Moscow one day, and we just said, you know, we really like anything about Samyatin. So little is known about Samyatin, the great author of We. Garek went to the archives because he charmed the archive ladies. Again, there were cracks in the monologue. You could bring presents, you could charm the archive ladies. And he came out with three letters that had never been seen before, and so little was known about Samyatin. And the next thing we know, he's arrested for anti-Soviet propaganda. And he was young, skinny, little, and the next visit to Russia, I remember I was alone, and Bidov was driving, and Aksyonov was in the car, and Oleshkovsky, and we were taking vitamins to Garek's mother to bake into the cookies so that he wouldn't die in the camps. And this was such a minor offense. I mean, I don't remember what books he had. Like, let's say he had one book by Solzhenitsyn, but something minor. It was stupendous that they would bother. Maram Zin had been looking for trouble a long time, and anybody connected with Brodsky was in trouble. But Garek Superfin, this just seemed amazing to me.
Wasn't he handling the archive of the Chronicle?
You know, I can't remember at that point. I can't remember what they were doing. He and Masha Slonim were always doing something, but it seemed very minor. That's all I remember. And No, I think other people were arrested for the Chronicle, but he could have held it overnight. It's true.
Well, not to end on the note of minor, but rather to thank you for this enlightening presentation and for being here. And please come up to Ellendea, say hello. The books are here for sale and signing. Thank you.